Blackstone Audio presents The Wings of the Sphinx by Andrea Camilleri, translated by Stephen Sartorelli. Chapter 1. Whatever happened to those early mornings when, upon awakening, for no reason, he would feel a sort of current of pure happiness running through him? It wasn't the fact that the day was starting out cloudless and windless, and the sun shining bright. No, it was a different sensation, one that had nothing to do with his meteoropathic nature. If he had to explain, it was like feeling in harmony with all of creation, perfectly synchronized with a great stellar clock precisely positioned in space, at the very point that had been destined for him since birth. Bullshit? Fantasy? Maybe. But the indisputable fact was that he used to have this feeling rather often. Whereas now, for the last few years, it was, so long, nice knowing you. Gone. Vanished. In fact, nowadays, early mornings very often inspired a feeling of refusal in him, a sort of instinctive rejection of what awaited him once he was forced to accept the new day, even if there were no particular hassles awaiting him in the hours ahead. And the proof of this was the way he acted upon emerging from sleep. Now, the moment he raised his eyelids, he immediately lowered them again, remaining in darkness for a few more seconds, whereas before, the moment he opened his eyes, he kept them open, even slightly agape, avidly taking in the light of day. And this, he thought, is surely because of my age. But immediately, Montalbano too rebelled against this conclusion. Because for a few years now, two different Montalbanos lived inside the inspector, and they were always in disagreement. The moment one of them said something, the other would assert the opposite. And indeed, as if on cue, "What's this about your age?" said Montalbano too. "How is it possible that at 56 you already feel old? You want to know the real truth?" "No," said Montalbano one. "Well, I'm going to tell you anyway. You want to feel old because it suits you just fine. Since you've grown tired of what you are and what you do, you've created this excuse about getting old. But if you really feel that way, why don't you write a nice letter of resignation right now and call it quits?" "And what would I do then?" "You would play the old man, get yourself a dog to keep you company, go out in the morning to buy the newspaper, sit down on a bench, let the dog run free, and start reading the paper, beginning with the death notices."
"Why the death notices?"
"Because whenever you read that someone your age has just died while you're still fairly alive, you feel a certain satisfaction that'll help you hang around for at least another 24 hours. An hour later, you and your dogs can go fuck yourselves," said Montalbano One, chilled by the prospect.
"Well then, get up, go to work, and stop being a pain in the ass," Montalbano Two concluded decisively.
While he was in the shower, the telephone rang. He went to answer it completely naked, leaving a stream of water in his wake. Adelina, in any case, would be by later to clean house.
"Chief, what'd I do, wake you up?"
"No, cat, I was awake."
"You're sure about that, Chief? You're not just saying that to be nice?"
"No, you needn't worry. What is it?"
"Chief, what else could it be if I'm calling you first thing in the morning?"
"Cat, do you realize that you never called to give me any good news?" There was a pause, and then Catarella's voice became all choked up.
"Ah, Chief, why do you say that? You want to humiliate me? If it was up to me, I'd wake you up every single morning with really good news, like, I don't know, like you just won 30 billions in a lottery. Or like you was just made chief of police, or..."
Not having heard the door open, the inspector suddenly saw Adelina standing before him, staring at him, keys still in hand. Why had she come so early? Embarrassed, he instinctively turned towards the telephone to hide his privates. Apparently, the male backside is considered less shameful than the front. The housekeeper quickly fled into the kitchen.
"Cat, wanna bet I know why you're calling? A dead man was found somewhere, am I right?"
"Yes and no, Chief."
"Where am I wrong?"
"It's a dead lady, Chief."
"Listen, isn't Inspector Algello around?"
"He's already at a scene of the crime, Chief. But the inspector just called me now saying to call you now, Chief, saying how is spitter if you go there too, Chief, poisonally and poison."
"Where was she found?"
"At a Sarcedo, Chief, round about the Merkin Bridge."
That was far along the road.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.